kid was laying right there, untouched, hadn't been ran over, just laying there. It's just like God laid right there and said, all I need you to do is trust me. But when I tell you, since I've transformed my thinking and made him my husband and my best friend, because I'm not going to cheat on him no more. I'm not going to cheat, because what do you get out of it? Because if I stay faithful, then I can be the lender and not the borrower. If I stay faithful and obedient and do as he said to do, then my life will change. And not only that, my kids, like my son, the oldest Jarvis, they just got blessed with a townhouse. God opened the door, shut the other doors, opened that door, and they moved to Friday. So even in my being obedient, I'm watching my kids be blessed, my grandchildren. So y'all, I'm going to tell you something. Being alone, I'm good. I'm good because I'm learning to trust God in everything.
One more before we get in. Is anybody else? All right. 1 Samuel 38. How to recover. How to recover. David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after this truth? Shall I overtake them? And the Lord asked him, saying, pursue. But thou shalt surely overtake them, and without fail recover. Oh, how to recover. First thing God had me to do with you guys is let's talk about what it really means to recover. Everybody in here, just about where everybody was willing to lift their hand, probably 90+% said that they had something in their life that they wish they could recover. Is that still true? There's some things I know I missed, some opportunity. There's some stuff I mishandled, some stuff I got too soon, some stuff I just didn't appreciate. But to understand what this is, and I want to have an exchange with you tonight on this, because this is so important. I just kept lingering on this today as I kept meditating about tonight. The whole idea of recovery, meaning again, cover from a biblical sense, and even just from an etymology sense. Cover means to protect. I don't think we understand that like we should, that whatever is given into my life, in order for me to maintain it and to nurture it, because I'm not supposed to get something and it stays the same. Everything, everyone that comes into my life, because they're connected to me, is supposed to grow. But I have to understand that part of my responsibility is to protect them. And so when I'm talking to God about recovery, I'm asking God, please, please give me permission to protect it again. Because 9.9 times out of 10, I lost it because I didn't know how to protect it. What does that say to me? Many of us are asking for stuff because the only thing we're familiar with is what we require. And what we think this thing, this person is going to bring into our lives that we're missing, but we're not being investigative enough to find out what does this thing, this opportunity, this person, this relationship, this assignment, what is it truly going to demand of me? In order that I might be able to keep it and grow it. And so we violate and we lose, then we're somewhere angry because we lost, which is wasted emotion, because truth be told, you lost because you didn't know how to keep it. So where should your focus be? protected. And I use the word adequately on purpose because, again, I need you to understand, y'all. And this might seem like it makes life more complex, but I hope it doesn't. I hope it just makes life clearer. Is in the fact that everything you want, and even everything you already have, all of them have different requirements. All of them. And if you don't know how to keep it, you shouldn't be surprised when you lose it. You shouldn't be surprised when it dies in your hands. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. And so it's the inanimate things, the houses, the cars, and all that. That stuff is easy to learn how to keep it and maintain. We still don't even do that. Right. Most of us ain't about riding around with a red light on in your car right now. That's something needs to be attended to. And you're just like, Lord, keep it. You know my heart, Jesus. What's more than that, brother Jesus? But those things have a tendency to come with manuals. And I should know what it takes to maintain it. It's the wild card are the people in my life. And so that's why I put that next bullet point. Because I said everything in your possession requires a different and evolving measure of protection. What do you think I mean by that? Evolve. Say again. Needs change. What's somebody say here?
Grow.
It grows. But listen to this. Sometimes you have the possession of things or relationships that won't always require the same level of protection. Mm-hmm. See, sometimes, especially this, the parents can really understand. Because what can happen to you as a parent, what can happen to you as a leader, is that you take your identity from who you cover.
Yes, mm-hmm.
Isn't that interesting? I'm covering, but my identity is because you're here. Which defeats the whole purpose of covering. And so when our kids are growing up, we have to learn how to evolve our level of protection. Mm-hmm. Because if you maintain the same level, you impede their maturation.
Mm-hmm.
You cut off their ability to grow. Does it make sense?
Mm-hmm.
How easy is that? It's hard as all get out. Especially if you got more than one youngin'. Because
mm-hmm.
each one requires a different. Now you gotta manage the fact that you making differences between us.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you're a leader in my position, I cannot treat everybody the same.
Mm-hmm.
You should watch your attitude. No, I'm showing wisdom and observation. Some people, you can treat them like a, you remember our class and leadership, like an S4, meaning that they don't need any supervision whatsoever. And you got someone that's S1, you got to stay right there. Now hold their hand. You still don't allow them to do the thing, but you realize they don't have the maturity or understanding, experience, resume to do it. So it's more of an OJT on the job training. But you have to learn. And so many of us haven't been able to progress relationally, progress professionally, because you didn't know how to protect what was happening. Does that make sense to you? And it's so quick to blame them, it, something else. In reality, it might just be. Does it make sense? So as we talk about that, now I want you to go back through your Rolodex of what you had in your head about what you want to become. The question that I posed to Sunday, did I put it up there? Yeah. So, before I ask for it back, have I learned how to protect it? That takes maturity. Especially in this relationship. Because you feel like this, the problem with that is that you feel like the longer I wait, the harder it is to get it back. And so what do we know what we do? understand it ain't gonna happen again this week. Because if it's still with me, I can't suppress that for so long. And most of the things that come out that are damaging are situationally driven anyway. You can hide it until the right situation shows up. And it's coming. And you'll reveal that not only did you not grow, but now you have progressed into being a liar. So now the trust is further eroded. I need you to understand that we're moving this slide. You gotta know what's required of whatever you pursue. And it ain't just what you want. It's what they need for the relationship to be maintained. Hmm. Does it make sense to you? So I understand covenant. I gotta be willing to protect, but at the same time, when it comes to human beings, they also have to have a willingness to be covered. Just because you're ready, they may not be ready. Comments, questions?
So, if what I'm covering, right?
Mm-hmm.
If I've learned how to protect it,
mm-hmm.
but my level of protection is not quite fully mature, like I know how to protect it on this level, should I expect some of it back?
Relationally speaking, all that takes a
minute. Or even business, or, you know.
Well, let's start with relationships. That's the hardest one to get in business too.
Right.
If I improved in some areas, but not completely. Mm-hmm. All right, let's be honest. Let's be honest about us.
Mm-hmm.
When I want you back.
Oh, I'll work it.
Right. I want everything. No, if I'm the one that lost, and I had three things I needed to work on, and I worked on one, I don't want 33% back. And that's only because I'm being selfish and immature.
Well.
What a mature stance would be is that my level of expectation should match my level of contribution. Because remember, we talk about relationships, and relationships have to be labeled with what word? And our word? Reciprocity. I gotta quit demanding more than I'm willing to give. Because if I put you in that posture, I'm gonna make this relationship unhealthy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm demanding 5 M&Ms and only giving you 2. Eventually, we both gonna be hungry. There has to be an equivalent exchange of what you need. And so the mature thing is this. See, what it's telling me to be taught is that if there's a strong enough desire for the relationship, there ought to be strong enough effort for me to grow. That's the part that we fall off on. Because when it's been made clear to you what the breakdown is, if you truly want it for the right reasons, you now focus on getting the help you need. That applies relationally, and in business, and any other thing. Wherever my shortfall is, if I want to maintain the position, and I desire for the position to be healthy for us both, healthy for me and whoever I'm in a relationship with, healthy for me and my employees, whatever, I need to bring the whole thing to the table. That needs to be the goal of it. And if I'm not willing to do it, I should expect there to be deficits in the area that I'm less than. That makes sense to you?
Yes.
Now, we'll lie. Still try to get the whole thing, but eventually that blows up too. If I'm truly committed to the welfare of us all, which ought to be my aim, I'm trying to shore up myself in every area of deficit. And walking around with a chip on your shoulder mad at folks because they made a declaration that you're not handling this well, That ain't doing anything. That's not going to draw nobody back. That's not going to draw no opportunities back. The situation is demanding that I grow. Y'all follow?
So, Pastor.
April, can I come back, please?
Okay, so it's still thinking about protection, protecting. If I lost it, but I want to recover it, should I still be attempting to protect it even though I no longer have it?
Well, the fact that you lost it says you can't protect it. Because the whole protection thing is, the protection ain't me, is not like me standing between you and the world. The whole covering thing is that you're protected in this relationship. I'm giving you what you need in this relationship. So me making an attempt to protect while not giving it what is needed is me lying to myself. Does that make sense? That's kind of like, okay, that's kind of like a dude telling you, dude telling a female, I'm paying your bills. You got a job. I pay my own bills. That's not what I asked you for. I asked you for conversation, communication, honesty. Or give me the cable bill. He still thinks he's doing his part. How you feel about that? Like, are you hearing the words coming out of my mouth? Because I'm evading the need and doing something else you didn't even ask for. And so we'll ask her to celebrate my effort while not hitting my what was asked for. You know what I mean? And we'll convince ourselves, well, I'm doing it. No, you're not doing what's asked for you. You follow me?
Yeah.
You can only answer my question because, but, you know, if I'm covering it, and, you know, it's there. But then if I, you know, back up and be like, you know, I'm tired. I just need a day, you know, to myself. And, you know, then they be like, the kids, my husband be like, well, why you not doing this? Why you not doing that? You know, just always want me to be the covering.
Right.
And how do you handle that? Because sometimes, you know, I just be like, you know, no, I'm not doing it.
But that's, to me, Sam, that's a conversation that needs to be had about reciprocity, you know. For folk who love you out there, they ought to be willing to say you ain't got to cook tonight. and then that speaks to some unhealthy nature of the relationship.
Okay.
And so here's the thing, when these contentious moments arise, those are opportunities for growth. What we have a tendency to do is treat those as opportunities to separate. Because okay. now we ought to be negotiating for reciprocity. Does it make sense to you guys? Because you got needs too.
So I should be, you know, letting them know, hey, I'm not going to do this because this is what y'all need to do.
Yeah, we need to work this out. We need to swap this up a little bit. I'm tired too. Those kind of conversations. And those can be held in a healthy manner if we don't wait till the volcano explodes.
Oh.
So it ought to be a continual conversation. Not suppress, explode on everybody.
Okay.
Then there's damage. Then there's damage beyond the situation.
Yeah.
Situation could have been remedied with conversation. Now when I explode, I'm telling you about everything I like about you, never liked your mom. Grandma really can't get me to the salad and nasty. you come in, you can get some. Right? Like I said, sometimes when I want to have a conversation that stings, we're going to wait until there's a compound fracture. We could have handled it when it was stained. It's a little uncomfortable. Necessary conversations are uncomfortable. Yeah, because we need to grow. We're pointing out some stuff that ain't right. And most of us still cringe over the thought of correction. You know? But let's deal with it when we can talk calm. Because after a while, we come to everybody's head. Kim?
How do you
also speak to areas of your own personal healing. Just because a relationship can't be restored, that doesn't mean you get a free pass on not fixing it. Because again, if you found out the places that were lacking in you that caused the relationship, the job, whatever, to fall apart, it would be wise of you to do what?
Work on it.
Because I don't want you even for your own self benefit, I don't want this to happen again. And see, that's the notion. We'll jump ahead a little bit. That's the whole notion of being the lamb. But being the lamb does not mean it's not that God goes and fights my battle. Being the lamb means I discover I'm the problem. I'm the problem. The problem is in me. So I've got to sacrifice me. I got to let something die in me. And it's so hard to be the lamb, because the lamb, like Keisha said, the lamb feels passive. But also the lamb means I got to have enough maturity to stop blaming everybody else. I got to have enough self-awareness to check me. It's me. And it's so hard for us to say those two words. It's me. Well, I wouldn't be that way if y'all. Because if I take that position, I'm waiting for somebody to free me. I'm waiting for y'all to get right so I can get right. I'm a prisoner. So I'm going to go ahead and deal with me. And in the process of dealing with me, I may unearth these other insecurities. And now I got to deal with that. If I feel like I ain't going to never have nobody else, why? Where did that sense of unworthiness come from? Now I got to deal with that. I got to deal with it. I got to deal with it. And I know God doesn't work until completion. But here's the deal. He will not violate. If I choose to be defeated, he will let me. Think about the man beside the pool of Bethesda. Jesus didn't jack him up. He said, do you want to be? And he did like we do. You know, Jesus, I would be by now, but I ain't got nobody to put me in the pool. Start rattling off all my stuff. Don't we? When the opportunity shows up. And so Jesus didn't pay any attention to that. He said, do you want to? And he said, grab somebody and tell them, come help you. You've been laying here long enough. Get somebody to get this bed while you get yourself up. What do you say? Pick up your excuse and walk. You see, most of us can't handle that kind of conversation. We'd rather be stroked than our misery. We really need somebody in our life to say, hey, you still down there? You still sound like that? You still talking like that? How does that work? Get up. Get up. Clean up.
That's good.
Fix your hair. Change your outfit. Come on. Yeah, wash. Wash. Come on, get out. Go with your life. Let's take this side over a second. I think many of us who desire people in our life that are compatible don't put ourselves in positions of compatibility. What I mean by that is that you nowhere near who you are in terms of doing the things that you enjoy. You can go be you. Be in the circles that interest you, be at the events that excite you. Because if I'm going to the things that stimulate me, I'm gonna be around people who are compatible.
Yeah.
So we're somewhere pretending to be something else, hooking up with somebody as someone else. And then once we think we got it, now you love me enough to reveal to you who I am. Oh, bait switch. And now you can't protect it because it ain't. continuously listen. It is a sad part about life. You get to choose the later. As awesome as God is, you can die where you are. And only he was less powerful. It meant that he sent you several messages. Get up. But Lord, okay, I'll be back next year. Get up. Does that make sense? Here's proof, again, here's proof that I know God does that. Because the older you get, the greater your regret is. As I told you, regret is an indication that I could.
Yeah.
I just didn't. You don't regret stuff. You don't regret stuff you have the inability to do.
Right.
I ain't somewhere else sad about not walking on the moon. I ain't so upset about not performing heart surgery already. You know, I haven't developed the capability, nor do I have the desire. But there's some stuff I've got the ability to do that I have not done, and I feel regretful about it.
Yes, sir.
Because I know that by now I should have. And my by now that I should have list only consists of those things I'm well able to do. But for some reason, I talk myself out of it. 9 times out of 10, I was trying to please somebody. Who you thought would be more endearing to you if you were less there. Yeah. Think about that. How crazy was that?
So, Pastor, if you are in a relationship, like if you're in a relationship with your family and you're trying to help them and they're not there yet, should you still be trying to protect those things that are going to grow in them, or are you waiting for them? What do you do when you're trying to protect them as they are being processed?
Well, let me ask you a question. How would you protect them if they ain't ready and they don't want what you have? How could you?
So what happens to that part of the relationship? I won't recover it?
That's not necessarily true because many of us have been able to reconnect with folks once weekly. And so, but you can't dictate their level of growth when they grow, their pace of growth. The only thing that you're responsible is for is make sure that Tony is as whole as she can be when she stands before God. And unfortunately, my willingness to be obedient to God sometimes is accurate. My obedience to God being pulled away from people that I wish would go with. There's some folks I really wish was with me. And you have a tendency to do what? I mean, again, the Bible shows you. You talk about Abraham a lot. You got a wonderful opportunity, but now you can delay the whole thing because now you got to stop moving forward to God and go check on Lot. Now you can move because Lot's people fight with your people. And so we can't even do the things of God because I'm too busy trying to referee something that shouldn't even be here. Because he wasn't mature enough. So I drug him in a place that his immaturity came through. So I'm partially responsible for that.
Absolutely.
Because I put you in a situation that was going to make demands of you that you couldn't deliver. Because I won't compromise. I won't compromise. I want the sense of knowing my familial obligation. Good family. Mm-hmm. Truth be told, you're not ready to move. That makes sense? You're not helping somebody who ain't ready to move and putting them in a position that's going to demand something they ain't got. As a matter of fact, you might be contributing to a greater setback. Because how did it affect you when you had responsibility that you learned that you couldn't handle? How what was your attitude the next time you had an opportunity? Was it the same level, or you were a little more scared, a little more gunshot, a little more apprehensive? Right.
Yeah.
And so I've got to allow you, as we've been talking, like we talk about in UBI, I can't put you in a position that's beyond your measure.
Yes, sir.
Paul said, do not go beyond your measure. And he emphasized the fact that let God orchestrate that. Now, if God's telling you to do something that's different, let's be honest, most of the time we're dragging it forward. We ain't had a conversation with God at all.
Right.
And you remember when somebody was trying to make you grow a all you did was perfect your rebellion. You got good at it. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Anybody else? All right. And so, we see David. So we're moving forward, and this whole idea that I'm trying to position myself to be somebody that is capable or demonstrates the maturity that I can become, that I can go get. And one of the things that you see David possessed was an ability to have emotional restraint in a highly emotional situation. This is so serious, y'all. Your emotional maturity is determining your future opportunities. You got to, if you got a chip on your shoulder because somebody told you no, they ain't going to trust you as a future with opportunity. Nah. Because you're showing, you're pouting. How can I trust you with demanding things if your little girl or your little boy comes out at no? Does it make sense? And so here's what you better understand. And so, but this does not say, and I don't want to give any kind of illusion, that you don't feel stuff. You have to develop the muscle that says, I won't let it rule me.
Yeah.
I can't let it rule me. I don't like how this happened. I don't like how I said it. I don't like all this. But the thing I've got to do is learning how to place my responsibilities above my feelings.
Yes, sir.
Because this whole thing I was supposed to say on that last slide was that I'm learning with every facet of life that demands some degree of responsibility from me. That whole protection thing is about responsibility. Your ability to respond. Everything is dictated by your ability to respond to that situation, that person, that thing. Responsibility is everything. And so I can access or tap into the self-control that came with the Holy Spirit as part of the fruit of the Spirit. And I got to do it intellectually too, logically, by saying my responsibility, I cannot vacate my responsibility because of what I feel. So I got to do what's expected of me with my heart broke. Feeling depressed, feeling isolated, feeling mishandled, I still got something to do. Because listen, when the emotion subsides, I don't want to lose the place. I don't want to forfeit the place for a temporary feeling. Does that make sense? I got to get rid of this. It's going to pass. I got history with my feelings. It's going to pass. I'm mad today, but give me by Tuesday. But I don't want to get to Tuesday and realize I have to screw up my position. So no matter how upset the men were at David, he was still the leader. Especially when you know it's a position given to you by God. Does it make sense? So even when people reject you, walk away, you don't let them take your position with them.
Sir, wait a minute.
You don't. This is how you handle it. Like, whether you're here or not, I'm going to keep developing. If you leave, you're going to miss out on this next level of business. Amen. And so people who don't understand the maturation it takes to say that, that sounds arrogant to you. No, that's not arrogance. I'm talking about hard work. I mean, I'm going to still develop and grow while knives are in my back. But your departure won't take my calling. Because I did this for me and God, you showed up. I'm trying to heal me. Because God called me into something that's healing me. And so I'm fighting me and really don't have time to fight you. So my battle ain't against flesh and blood. My battle is against these principalities, these things that are inside of me that's trying to make me give you too much power. Because I'd rather for you to like me than for me to my fate in the hands of fickle people. You could be the greatest thing in the world one week, and they all fire you the next.
You teach yourself.
Can you be sound enough in yourself that I take me and my goodness elsewhere? If you need it. Does that make sense? So again, I want to echo it, because trust me, and I'm talking from my own personal experience, because a lot of the scripture starts to make sense when you start grabbing this stuff and holding on to it. The text that says, set your face like flint.
Yeah.
Why would God even mind us that to us? Why would he tell us to do that?
We need it.
Mm-hmm. Did you say, baby?
Eventually, we would need that advice. That
why do you need it? Under what circumstances do you need it?
Anytime you're battling.
You're battling?
Oh, when people try to put things on you.
Absolutely.
Like shame.
You need to be to set your face like that when you're standing in front of folks.
Yes, sir.
Who don't like the fact that you got that spot. Because people forever have been trying to do the same thing that Jezebel was doing. To the king, you know, she was used to being able to break men down by staring at them. It's in the book.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the book. And so if the symbolism, because it's deep symbolism, because the Bible tells you that she'll be presented as God in a good way. The Bible says she her court, the people that served her, she had surrounding her were eunuchs. You know what a eunuch is?
Yeah,
a castrated man. A man that now can't perform, has no potency. She took power away. Her whole Jezebel spirit is one that wants to strip you of power. So she surrounded herself with men who should be men, who couldn't perform like men because they did her. Mm-hmm. And so when Jehu came to deal with her, the Bible says she got herself together, put the eyeliner on and stood in the window and looked at him as he came in. It was normally that works. And a man who still had power to talk to the eunuchs and say, hey, throw her down. I'm going to give you your power back. And so I got to be strong when somebody's trying to strip me with their look. You get it all the time. Trust me. You do. You be a preacher. You know who mad at you. You know who mad at you. So you just go right over there where he is. Lord said. I'm kidding. Sorry to count. Not really. But when you're standing in a conviction, I got to see this regardless of how pissed you are with me. Because I think what you feel like you lost from me. But did you protect it? Also, in these situations, you got to understand this little right now. Can you stay amongst the noise? The noise of those that are affected, I said secondarily, cannot deter your determination to get to God in the matter. When it's highly emotional, everybody got something they want to say. People who are not the primary target of it. If you're the leader, you're the primary target of whatever's happening. Because there's still the premise of if I kill the shepherd, the sheep will what? So the sheep feel the splatter, and so the sheep feel like they got to say so. They get to dictate what your next move is. When all in all reality, we wouldn't even be here had I not listened to God. And so you gotta understand that although you're pulling, you got all these folks pulling at you, and it's your natural tendency to want to respond. And I'm not telling you don't respond and try to keep calm, but your advisor should not be the one you were leading yesterday. How do they become above you now? And so what I've got to do, because if you could be leading, then I would be following you. And so again, it's like people leaving me don't take my title. Circumstances walk away with my title either. And so now I gotta talk to God. What do I do? That's what David did. He demonstrated that to you. You gotta understand that, and that's hard. But you're relational, you got everybody coming at you, but you gotta get off to yourself and say, Father, what is this? And how do I go about it? Asking God the right questions. Because I mean your destiny is attached to your ability to make correct choices. You don't forfeit your destiny that you might delay. You don't choose well. Mm. And so if you gotta ask the right questions, please understand that. You gotta learn how to ask the right questions. Your ability to ask questions actually shows your level of comprehension of the subject matter. I recognize that in class, but when I'm teaching sometimes, I recognize the question reveals that you're not listening. Because the question that even or you haven't talked about it, but you haven't thought about it enough to ask the question in an appropriate manner. And so it's important for you to figure out how to ask it so you can get what you need. Quit talking just to talk. I need something out of this. I'm missing a piece of this puzzle, so I gotta ask the question so that I can get the answer. And so the first thing he asked was, Shall I pursue? As I shared with you Sunday, for the highly emotional folks, that sounds crazy. Like we've already lost something. You know, aren't scared we're gonna pursue. But the reality of it is, if I am submitted to God, as Jackie said, if I've made God my husband, I need to run this by him. I don't care what it looks like. I want it. I think I need it. Good God, I miss it. But should I go again? How much mature you gotta have to say that? How much trust in God you gotta have to say that? And most of us don't do that automatically. You end up chasing a whole bunch of stuff, and once you catch it, you're like, Lord God, come get it. Am I right about it? And so after a while, you learn how to go. Wait a minute. You get that flashback. Wait a minute. The last joke I called. So I want to know. I want to know. Because truth be told, I really don't know all I need to know. It feels like lost care. It feels like I lost something. And there go them feelings again. I feel like I lost something. But I need to check. Did I lose it, or did you take it? Because sometimes God answers your prayers in ways you didn't expect. Lord, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. God says, okay, let me get it. You're like, wait a minute, Lord, I ain't say I want to be alone. But he's saying, this is why you're sick and tired. Lord, I'm sick. Quit telling God I'm sick of this job. He's like, okay. But I got to find out. But here's the deal. If it's divine purging, God is still trying to help me to lay aside weight, to reveal to me. It's a lot of times that he's trying to show me how I've been flirting with idolatry. Sometimes I have some things and some people attached to me that will make me say no to him. Don't. And so sometimes he's trying to spare us and find ourselves in a position. So the question I had is that can you let it go? Can you let it go if the people tell you to go back? Yeah. Or vice versa. Will you go after it if everybody say let it come? It drives me back to the feet of God. Because I'm still trying to figure out, do I pursue, how I pursue. Let's get to the half of it. Do it quickly.
Pastor John.
Yes.
Are there maybe two or three foundational things that you should, when you get to the part about, you know, if people are telling you to pursue, student, but God is saying no, or vice versa. Are there any foundational things, like maybe one or two things that I should look for to say if God is telling me not to or to pursue? Or the things I should look for to be able to identify? What if I'm just confused? Like, I don't know what to do. I don't know if I should pursue or not.
The first thing that came to my spirit when you said that, but I didn't hear you say that, I'm confused. Again, God, I know all of that, but the first thing that came to my mind was stand still. Don't do nothing. That's hard. Mm-hmm. But listen, I'm still trying to get clarity from whom?
God.
Not them. And they lie. People are lying. People are demanding people make you feel like you owe it to them to go chase, but you owe it to them to let them go. But what I've got to be disciplined enough, at whatever cost, to make sure I heard God. And I weave out those for us to say this, even if I move on thinking that I heard God, my backstop to that is that he promises me, he corrects those who he loves. So even if I move, because I've made some moves where I thought I heard it. And he stepped in my moving. Does it make sense? He's promised me that. And so that ought to give us some sense of comfort, because most of us act like we're playing double dutch and they're going to never jump in. And God's like, come on, just move. Just move. Trust me. Trust me that I got you. I got you. I got you when you ain't got you. And we already got a track record of that. God had me when I was doing stupid stuff. God took good care of me when I was a straight up fool. Nut. Now I'm going to take care of me when I'm aiming to please him.
That's good.
He got me. And he got this one clause, April, that's inescapable. And that one clause is this. All things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. God, I'm chasing the purpose. I thought I heard you. Don't worry. I'm going to make that work. You love me? God, you know, I move because I love you, and I thought I heard you. I got you. Remember, he done seen the movie anyway, so he ain't surprised by your misstep. As a matter of fact, I took a detour, didn't know it was a detour. I thought it was the main road, but he already saw I could take the detour, so he stuck some business on the detour. That's what he promised. See, it's hard for us to fathom that, because if you understand that, you'd be doing something, you'd be moving. Because if I get that, I'm no longer, I cannot understand being anxious for nothing. Because my anxiety is that I'm going to mess up.
Right.
And God is saying, you won't mess up if you do it for me.
That's good.
Wait a minute, what is that? No, you won't mess up if you're doing it for me. But should I have turned left? Ideally, but I prepared the right. Because you're doing it for me.
Yeah.
See, we don't want to believe him like that, because we still want to condition him like people. Because people rolling with you, God's rolling ahead of you. I've already seen that. And so I knew you was going to miss it back there in 79. I knew you was going to miss it in 2012. I knew that. I knew you was going to make a bad choice. I knew you were going to do the wrong thing. But I had you, because I knew, I've seen the whole thing. I got you. And see, it's incomprehensible to even fathom love like that. Because I'm trying to learn how to cover, not realize I am covered. So if covered is protecting, guess who's protecting me? You got me. You heard me say that? I read the scripture all the time. You're so covered that even if you make your bed,
yes.
Come on now. Even if you screw up and end up in the worst state.
Absolutely.
God has a two-question test for you. Question one, do you to any purpose.
My God.
You don't want help from my benefit? Watch me. God, I done messed up too bad. Come, let us reason together. He got a response for everything. I said, Lord, I can't go. Come with me, God, this is it. Let's call it. Watch. Make them white. This is Scarlet was a red ink that could not be removed. Y'all thinking about cloth that you go buy at the store? No, there was a picture of the dye that they used that once it got on something, it could not be removed. God said, you think your sins are like that? Come here. I'm going to remove everything, every excuse you say you have, as long as question one. Got a vested interest in helping you succeed. Because you ain't doing it for you no more. My prayer, this is how I pray. I throw this in God's face. Hey, it's your glory. Yes, sir. Help me. It's your glory. I'm trying to please you. I am. Being all my stuff, trying to please you. Hey, don't let me get to the point where I'm irrecoverable. It's your glory. Protect your glory. It ain't mine. It's yours. Look out for me, please. So I don't make you look too bad. So I'll protect them. We'll have to fight. How do I fight? Am I the lion or the lamb? Lamb, let's get through this real quick. I'm the lamb when the enemy's where? It's me. So, I offer by you the lamb versus the lion. Come on and accept it. We in therapy right now. Just accept. I know you want to be ruled. Yeah. Most of the time, the defect is not in my environment. But even if it's in my environment, it can affect me until it gets me. I can be great even in a flawed world. That's how fearful one to be. So I need to sacrifice me. Let me put myself up on this altar and let God kill something. Show me I don't need it. I don't need this attitude. I don't need this belief. I don't need these things that I needed when I was growing up here because of my house, because of my neighborhood, because of my gender, because of my color. I don't need that anymore. I transcended those things. I'm bigger than that. I know principles now. I know his way. And his ways are still higher than mine. So you ain't nothing you can put in me, put in front of me that can stop me. Am I right about it? His ways are so good, he said, I'll make your enemies bless you. That's in the book, right? That means they ain't even gotta like you. They might not ever like you. And still help you. I can't stand you but him. Thank you. Did you spell my name right? Y'all, I'm dead serious. You can hate me. Pull up to my place with a rebel flag, mega hat, go back to Africa t-shirt. Spell the name right on the chat. And so, amazing about the king. The king was ready for battle. You got a picture that David was going to war. But David, in the midst of all of that, took his war clothes off because he knew, let me check, make sure this ain't my issue. So bring me the ephod. Bring me the priestly attire. That's why I say you have to spiritually travel with two sets of clothes. And the one that's going to get worn out the most is your ephod. Yo, the war clothes. I still have a tag on it for me. The ephod will get worn out because you're going to be, Lord, let me just get the heist myself on this altar the whole time.
Hi, sir. You're right.
Amen. So that's amazing. That's an amazing example. I got people threatening to kill me. One man threatened to kill me. Would you take off your war clothes? Picture the environment. Y'all ready to fight me. what I look like putting down my spirit. What I look like putting down my soul. God shows you an extreme situation to show you what you can do, because yours will never be better. So I'm gonna go past. You got, because that when I see that in my head, they were literally picking up stones, carrying the stone. He put on his priestly garment and lay in the floor and worship. Can you be that trusting on that? And he didn't even have the blood of the Holy Spirit either.
Wow.
So the scripture calls you now, because of Christ's sacrifice, you're the king. You are a king and a priest. So that's who you are at all times. Sacrifice of Christ, who became sin for me. So now he got me, my issues in him. Did I lose it because I failed? Yeah, thank you. Did I lose it because I failed to protect you from something that was in me? Last slide, the lion that everybody wants to be is when the enemy is outside of me. And even when the enemy is outside of me, I don't get to fight with these hands. I don't. There's kingdoms and stuff of violence, and violence had to be taken by force. Where's the kingdom?
In you.
So if I put hands on you, do I get to your kingdom?
No.
No. No. No. It's about principalities. So I'm not called to be a warrior when the battle is external. I'm called to be a teacher. Only the word destroys yours, not your hands. And so God is teaching you to be a pursuer of wisdom, so that we can exchange wisdom, being skillful in warfare, skillful in administration. Warfare means I'm going to teach you how to get ahead. Administration means I'm going to teach you how to keep it moving. And you're not going with these. Everything began when God opened this. Everything is maintained by you knowing how to deal with this. I'm going to speak it to a better place. I'm going to keep this sowing seeds until it catches. And it may not catch in my lifetime, because some soul, some water, God is increasing. It's not a job that I saw. He gives seed to who? See, we want that scripture just to mean money. The most important seed you're showing it is God's way of doing. So if you're willing to sow that, God keeps giving you more. That gives you influence. Over a long time, might get you to know. Don't do it backwards. Don't chase money. Chase value. All right, that's it. Come on, let's sing. Everybody good?
Yes.
Challenged?
Yes.
Convicted?
Yes.
Mad at the preacher? No. There's another person that can't be on the safety list. Tony and Cassie permanently banned from safety list. Father, we're so grateful for it, my lady. Somebody who's here getting it with me, so if I lose it, I can just call. Thank you for helping me to see me in the text. Not just my presence, but you also showed me hope in the text. You showed me a way to salvation, a way to working out my soul salvation. There is a way for me to get better. And I will. I will. Father, not only do I want to stand before you and hear you say, well done, but before I leave here, I want to meet the me that you intended for me to be. I want to live as him. Have an offering, please leave it on the table. These lights ain't free.